guys. I think his name is Matt.
Matt, maybe. Matt.
Good evening and welcome to the Monday, January 9th special meeting and public hearing of the Hopkins School Committee. If you would please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So I will take us quickly through the agenda, but first I just want to announce that Mr. John Graziano will be participating remotely due to geographic difference, due to business travel, geographic distance, I'm sorry, can't even read my own handwriting, due to business travel tonight, and so he is on the phone, on speakerphone, and I think as loud as we can get him. HCAM says they can hear him, so we have that recorded. All right, so our agenda this evening, we first will have our first opportunity for public comment, and then we will move into the public hearing portion of our meeting, which will be to have a public hearing on fiscal year 18 budget. And then we have one item of new business this evening, which is the superintendent's budget recommendation. After that, we have our second opportunity for public comment and then adjournment. So at this time, I would seek a motion to open the public hearing scheduled for this evening for the purpose of discussion of the fiscal year 2018 school department budget.
So moved. Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Knight. All those in favor, and it needs to be a roll call vote. So Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
And I'm a yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. So we now have opened our public hearing. And Dr. McLeod, I believe you have a presentation for us this evening.
So at our last meeting,
I was supposed to do that.
Actually, 2 meetings ago, a proposal. And this is essentially the very similar presentation, given that we didn't have any recommendations on changing it in any way.
That was the meeting back on December the 18th. So we want to begin by thanking all these people. This is really a collaborative effort, this building of the school budget. And as I've worked with you and different committees over the years, I think that we have really developed a very transparent and open process where people have opportunities to ask questions. We openly invite not only participation by appropriations and Board of Selectmen, but they actually sit at the table and ask questions. And I've learned a lot from that process. I think I want to thank you for being very flexible. I really want to make sure that we call out the staff. And when I put that on the slide, when I think about staff, I just think about all of the people who work in our system who really are affected by the budget, whether it be in the classroom or in the cafeteria. I mean, there just are so many people that make this a fabulous place to work and learn, and they need to be recognized. It's always with a sigh of relief when we get to the end of the budget process and people can be kind of focused now on the rest of this year, knowing that the things that they're hoping will be covered in the budget will be approved. The central office team has worked tirelessly on this budget, really rolling up their sleeves to try to find any penny that we could save. Likewise, the administrative team, who you know how proud we are of all of them. And then the community. I think the questions that we receive as we go through the budget process really helps us to be mindful of what matters most, and really guides our recommendations in thinking about making sure that we have the best system for our students. And the committee liaisons, what I meant was that those Mr. Herr representing the Board of Selectmen and Mr. Manning representing Appropriations. Mr. Kamalo also came to a couple of our meetings. I know how busy he is, so just thank you to everybody. The thing that we stressed back in December, and as we think about the budget development, we're very proud in Hopkinton to provide an education that focuses on the whole child. And I don't need to go through all of this again, because we went through it very thoroughly back in December. But it is important to take note of that without all of these other things that we have, the social emotional wellness, the wonderful opportunities for kids through athletics, music, and clubs, and the arts, I believe very strongly that all of those things contribute to the achievement success that our kids have. That just focusing on academics, it would not realize the successes that we do as a district. And then I'm just going to call out a few of the achievements. I have pared it down from the initial original presentation, but the presentation from December is up on our website, so anybody who wants to get more details can do so. So Elmwood's, the reason I want to really call this one out, the best overall scores in the past 4 years in math as well as in ELA, 86% of students proficient or advanced. It's very important to stress for the community that the results that we look at in third grade are the culmination of the work that goes on from preschool through to third grade. This is the first year where we have MCAS results to look at, and I'm not sure that people who don't have children in the system or young children in the system realize that. So when we talk about the Elmwood achievement is a result of the work of the past 4 years in all of those grades and the programmatic improvements that you have approved along the way to allow us to show this kind of evidence of the achievement for our youngest students.
Kathy, could I interrupt
please,
for a second, because I just recognized that there's a bit of an issue with the handouts. When the Director of Finance put the original in the copier, he forgot to hit two-sided to two-sided. So what was handed out tonight is missing roughly half of the presentation.
That Director of Finance,
so
let's blame him.
you must have the original.
Wow.
Okay.
There you go. Again, so, this will be up on the website tomorrow.
Yeah.
But thank you.
Yeah.
This is a slide that Dr. Kavanaugh had provided us with this information, and I realized that not everybody is maybe familiar with growth percentiles. So I reworked the slide to look at, you know, what we're really looking at for all students, high needs, and students with disabilities. The reason this slide is very important is that this is where our classification as to whether we're level 1, 2 comes from. It's growth percentile. So even though we Elmwood and Hopkins is still level 2 and inching along, you can see the achievement overall throughout the district that we have. So 71, 65, 70 for all students growth percentile, that doesn't mean that that's our achievement level. Our achievement level is way beyond that. What that means is that we are growing at a percentile from year to year that is well above the expectation. So 4 to 60 is right in the middle. That's average. Anything above 60, when you look at a growth percentile, we are very excited about. And then below 40, not great at all. So if we look at all students, our growth over time is consistently above the 60 mark. When we look at our high needs students, again, high needs made up of ELL, students with disabilities, and students on free and reduced lunch. That high needs population, you can see the growth over time, consistent and steady, so that we are now within just slightly above that 40 to 60 range that we want to see for student growth for all students. And then if we take the students with disabilities out of the high needs population, so that's a subset of high needs, you can see the same kind of pattern as we're seeing for high needs students over time, and we're delighted to see this. We know that if we continue on the track that we're going and continue with the programs and the interventions that we have in place, that we are continuing to improve, that we hope to be level one across the district, if not next year, the year after. You've seen where we are. So I wanted to clarify this slide because I think it's a really important one that shows our performance in these areas across the district. This is our celebration slide to just be so excited that the middle school reached their target for all students and are now a level one school. Level one for meeting the gap and narrowing goals. So that has to do with growth, which is the slide that I just explained to you. The high school similarly maintained their level one status. So we talk about this all the time. It's great to meet level one status, but it doesn't mean that you can sit back and feel like, okay, we're there. We have to continue doing the things that we're doing and improving them even more. I know that Evan talked to you about some ideas that he has for meeting the college level and the placement criteria for students that we were cited on the CAP review, the CPR. And those are the kinds of things that will continue to put us at a level one status. But of course, most importantly, it will continue to ensure that we're meeting the needs of all of our students. These are some programmatic changes that have been supported in the past budget. The reason this is a really important slide is because the school committee, all of you, commented, and I noted that you commented when the principals particularly were presenting, that they all spoke to the support that they've had over the past several years for program changes and requests, and that therefore they weren't asking for anything in addition this year, no new programs, because these are all the things that have been supported by the school committee and by the town over the past 4 years. And I added the assistant principals wasn't on the original slide. That was something that we brought on 4 years ago, and it was brought on consistent with the implementation of the education evaluation system and the amount of time that was going to take to evaluate, which is a good thing. We're getting more information, but that was a big change to past practice. So these were assistant principals at the elementary level. And the other things I think we've really talked about throughout this whole process. The strategic initiatives that we call out in the budget process each year are specific to the year. So as you can see on this slide, we're talking about 1-2-B and 1-3-A. Clearly within that, if I were to pull up the entire strategic plan, there would be a 1-2-A and a 1-3-B. We are calling out specifically within these five areas, two specific goals under Strategic Initiative 1, two under Strategic Initiative 2, and then you can see again, three goals under Initiative 3 and two under 4. We've achieved all of our goals in the strategic plan under 5 already, so we don't even have them on there. And it's important to call this out because these are the ways in which we make decisions about our budget recommendations. Where are we in the strategic plan? Where is the focus and where does it need to be? And I think it certainly helps me when I am making decisions about where I should be focusing time, energy, and money when I reflect back to these initiatives. And even sometimes saying, boy, that's a really important thing for us to think about, but it's really not a priority this year. Let's see where it falls in the scheme of our five-year plan. I really enjoyed this slide. As I was thinking about it, I added quite a few. Because when we talk about unfunded mandates, the biggest piece of the mandate that we talk about being unfunded is time. Any of these initiatives that we're required to do by DESE requires time. And when we say it's not funded, it simply means that the individuals who are taking on these additional responsibilities, we're not adding positions. So we've talked about L requirements, the training that all teachers had to participate in, but then also that the training had to be provided. The addition of the teachers is outside of that. We talked last week about the science standards and the fact that we now have to order all sorts of new updated materials that will match the standards. That has not been funded. That's funded by individual towns. This is the new one, the opioid policy and prevention curriculum. Lori and I were talking about this one in terms of there being a new requirement that there not only be a policy, that the policy is updated, that the curriculum is provided. We are really fortunate in this district because we have a very really well-developed health curriculum, but not all districts do. And so I was able to work with Bruce Elliott to develop and pull all of the things that we're doing, and he had to add to that to create a K-12 prevention curriculum, which now needs to be filed with the state, but there is no funding for that either. So if we were a district that didn't have all of those resources available to us, we would really be scrambling right now to find the funding to provide this requirement. Bullying reporting regulations, that went back several years ago, but again, it was a priority. And you know, last year, everybody was trained on restraint, and the new requirements. It affected policy. It affected how we respond to restraint. These are all great things, and it's resulted in some really good improvements, but it made everybody kind of stop in their tracks and pay attention to that. And then there are new regulations on public records review. There's no funding behind that, but it's something that we are required. It's simply, we're told one day that it needs to be in place, and this is how it's going to change, and this is what it's going to now cost, which is less. That's all time that takes away from the focus of what people are otherwise doing. And then you know that we just went through an MSBA assessment. Every town did. It took the better part of 2 full days for 3 of our, you know, our buildings and grounds person, my assistant, and then the building principals, who had to take a portion of their day to spend so that they would be able to get the information that they needed. So I wanted to explain this slide. It's something that all districts respond to, and typically it's a very short window in which we need to be prepared to do that. So at this point, at this time in the presentation, I am going to pass this over to my partner here, Mr. Dumas.
Okay, the enrollment projections. This slide includes all students for whom the Hopkinton Public Schools are financially responsible. So it does not include students from Hopkinton who go to Tech. We are not financially responsible for those. The town gets charged an assessment by Keefe Tech. However, it does include all the students who come here every day. It includes students who are out of district in special education programs, and it also includes students from Hopkinton who attend Norfolk Agricultural School in Walpole. At the high school, you see an increase in students. That's caused by the current eighth grade class, which has been historically known as the bubble class. There are 311 eighth graders this year, and most of those are expected to go to the high school next year. The middle school has a decrease because A, they're losing the bubble class, and B, the fifth grade class that we currently have is a relatively small one at 225 kids. So there is a decrease at the middle school next year, but that's a one-year decrease. Elementary schools, fairly large increase, as you could imagine. The biggest expected increase is at the kindergarten and first grade level. Preschool at this point in time is, that's a space issue. We can't grow that program any larger than 65 because of space constrictions. We're anticipating the same number of students out of district on special education programs, but they will not be the same students. Mm, we have some students who are graduating this year, however, we are projecting that there will be other students who, between now and the end of this year, will probably be out of district, and as a result, out of district next year. Norfolk Aggie, there are 2 kids graduating this year. So the question would be, well, why are you assuming that 2 more will go? Because that's been the recent history, that we've been getting 2 or 3 students every year going to Norfolk Aggie. So their enrollment period, the enrollment application period, doesn't really get going until February. So we don't know who's going to apply. We're assuming that 2 will graduate, and there'll be 2 new students in the ninth grade next year. The budget development shows, you know, where we've been since the original requests, which are really adjusted original requests, because if you looked at what Dr. McLeod and I first saw from all of the principals and directors, it was higher than 6.99%. But in the second go around, that's where we were. So we knew that, you know, obviously that wasn't going to fly. And so we've made all of the reductions and changes that everybody has come before you and presented since, I guess, the middle of November. The important number up there is the original requests for existing staff, the $1,095,000. What that represents is the contractual obligations next year for staff who are currently working. So you can see that there's a reduction there. So what we've done is some of the people who are currently on staff either will not be here next year for a variety of reasons, or will be doing other jobs. They will be replaced, however, by some new staff members in other areas. And the expenses, you can see that we reduced that significantly. So right now, where we're at is a 4.13% budget increase. The budget overview, this shows that historically, payroll has represented 82% of our budget. And so our budget is up $1,688,000, and $1,266,000 of that is payroll. On the expense side, the increase is pretty much driven by special education costs and some increases in technology. Payroll changes, this is where that important number that I mentioned before comes back in. So contractual obligations, if we did nothing and just continued with the same people that we currently have, our budget would have gone up $1,095,000. You do see that there are some personnel reductions, and there are, this is where those new personnel are coming in that I mentioned earlier. So the total payroll increases net is $1,266,000. The other side of the coin is the non-payroll expenses. And this shows by educational program where those increases come in. I mentioned technology earlier. Central office, the biggest piece of what makes up that $18,000 is actually transportation. We are adding another bus next year, which will cost about $60,000, but it's being offset by reductions in other areas of expenses in central office. The addition of another bus is necessitated, particularly on the western part of town, in the area of the Hopkinton Muse apartment building. The buses that currently serve that area right now at the high school and middle school level are basically packed. We don't have a lot of empty seats right now in the morning for new students who we project are going to be moving into that area. Curriculum and professional development is textbooks, mostly in the area of science. You've heard the principals all talk about the new science curriculum that the state that we in the state are turning out. Athletics, there's an increase of $42,000 made up of a variety of things that were presented
by our new AD
and by Evan Bishop, mm-hmm. The principal at the high school. Regular education actually has a decrease. That would be supplies and books in the regular education classroom. The principals all shared with you that they really scoured their inventory and have determined that that they can make those reductions. Buildings and grounds and utilities, we are anticipating a reduction in our natural gas, A, because of a new contract, and B, because the past budgets have consistently been higher than we've actually used. And so we're rolling the dice a little bit there, hoping for what I would call a normal winter as opposed to a very, very cold winter. We haven't had a very, very cold winter here since FY10. So we are rolling the dice there a little bit, but, you know, we'll find out next winter how
well,
good.
Well, it's supposed to be 50 on Wednesday, Ralph.
That's so. Right. I did notice that. I'm not worried about this year's. occupational day, the problem, the occupational day, that's the Norfolk Aggie kids. In FY17, we budgeted for 5 slots, and we ended up with 7. And each kid costs $25,000 plus transportation. And so, as I said, we're budgeting the same number of kids that we have this year, but we only budgeted 5 in FY17. If we have 7 in FY18, it's going to lead to a budget increase. In special education, it's simply the cost of additional tuitions, transportation, our transportation assessment from the Accept Collaborative is probably the biggest line item increase in that area because we are transporting a lot more kids now, both in and out of district, on special ed vans. Total expense increase, $422,000. And the next two slides, I'm going to leave to, I know that Dr. McLeod loves these slides, but okay, I'll do it. So the DESE, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, takes all the financial data that's submitted to them by the all the school districts in the state, and all of those reports that we send in are subject to audit, so I want everybody to know that. And so they take that information and they publish per pupil expenditures. And the cost per pupil includes all costs associated with education in the community. So, for example, it's not only the school budget, it's a portion of the town's budget for school-related expenses. The biggest school-related expense that the town picks up is health insurance. Plowing is in there. Everything that you can imagine that the town does for us.
Chapter 70 gets involved?
Yeah. Yep. And so the other thing that's in there is all grant money.
Yep.
And all expenditures from revolving accounts. So we looked at the surrounding districts, and we're on the second page, and I'm looking for us. So we're third from the bottom. $13,535. And these are FY15 numbers because the FY16 numbers have not yet been published. So this is the most recent information that DESE publishes, and there's no real reason for us to expect any major shift in where we are in relationship to the other tech and Accept districts.
And the reason we call this out, and the reason, as Mr. Dumas said, I love it, is because it feels to me that we're making a statement to the town that we are doing an exceptional job and we're not asking for more money to do that exceptional job. And the other thing that's important to remember is that unfunded mandate, slide, because it could mean that, well, while we're doing all these other things that we're being required to do, other things are suffering, and we're not letting that happen. It's a credit to the people that work here, absolutely. They just will take it on and do it and get it done and without complaining, maybe complaining a little. But I think this is an important slide for you and for the community to see when we compare ourselves to what we're asking the town to spend per pupil and consider that with respect to our achievements. And that's our presentation.
Great. Thank you. Obviously, it's a public hearing, so if anyone from the public would like to come up and ask a question or make a comment, you're more than welcome. That and I neglected our public comment section right before opening the public hearing, so I wanted to make sure everyone had an opportunity. Also, okay. Did anyone in the school committee have any questions or comments for Dr. McLeod? I know that we've seen this presentation prior, but if anything's come up in the last few weeks since we've had time to sit and think about our budget since we last met on the budget. Go ahead, Jane.
I have a couple things to say, but I can go last. I usually go first.
That's okay.
Take all the airtime. All right, well, I have a couple of points that I'd like to make. First, Nancy and I were at TAC when they handed these numbers out, or similar, not all these same districts, but on Friday, and so it was a very proud moment for us. We got a lot of nice credit, because the other thing that's important to note is that if you made a slide of achievement or ranking by basically any standard, we would be at the very top of that list. And so I just, to me, what it says is that even though the town does invest significant funds in education here, they are getting a good value. We all know that's why people move here, because kids are our greatest resource. resource here in Hopkinton, and I just am very proud of the value. So I'm glad you included that slide, those slides. The unfunded mandates, I just wanted to also remind us that the educator evaluation system that you mentioned, also a huge one in terms of time, but in addition, the technology that we've been required to invest in for the testing like MCAS or whatever the next version of MCAS is going to be, also incredibly expensive. And so, again, something that we've absorbed and found ways to take, you know, to get done while still staying close to the target that we've been given by the town. So at the end of the day, the one thing that we didn't really discuss this year that we usually discuss every year is fees. And I know, you know, many years ago, there were a lot of comments at town meeting around reducing fees for transportation, for athletics, for everything that we do here. A former version of the school committee did commit to reducing fees every year until they were eliminated. We are not reducing fees this year. But I do want to point out that last year we completely eliminated the elementary transportation fee, which I think was a really big step forward. We've not had any feedback from any. All of our fees have been lowered to a level that it seems to me that parents are comfortable with. It's much lower than any other districts. So it's just a very circular way of saying that's why I didn't make my usual nagging requests about the fees this year. I think it's something we probably should think about next year if we want to continue to decrease them, or if we feel like we're just at a level where we're comfortable compared to other towns. So that was it, other than just to say, you know, at a really high level, I think, you know, you have delivered on what we've asked you to do. You came here. We worked hard on a strategic plan. Most of the expenses and big programmatic changes were in the first couple of years. We're seeing the return on that investment. You promised that you weren't just going to come up with something new and shiny every year, and this budget really reflects that. As you said, there are no big new programmatic requests, which is consistent with our strategic plan as well as the commitments that we've made to the town. So that is my long speech about, you know, I think this is probably the easiest budget cycle I've been a part of in 8 years. So, you know, job well done. And I think the final thing that I wanted to say is that it will never be the same going forward to do this without Mr. Dumas, who just has done a tremendous job. You're so responsive. You're so flexible. You help me with my little pink calculator to understand some very big numbers. And, you know, you bring such integrity and such competence to this position. And we really are sorely going to miss you. So we should have had a cake or something for your last big budget vote. But
this is my 32nd public hearing on a budget.
Wow.
And I want to thank you for that. And I want to ask you if you wouldn't mind posting that on Facebook. Flexible.
I know, okay. Just the group.
Need a good picture, Ralph.
That's right.
I'll get you a good one.
The first one you were in, or the 32nd?
I'll get you my college dormitory picture with long hair.
Oh, camera ready.
Yeah.
All right, here he comes. 32nd.
Oh, here we go. Number 32.
That's good. John, you missed it, but Mike just came and took a picture of Ralph right in the middle of our public hearing, which is fabulous.
That's what he had to say.
That's right.
Do you still have on there?
We do. I think he might be on mute. John, okay. You're still with us, right?
You could be watching online.
I don't know much. You could probably hear over there.
I don't know if he's still with us now that you say that. John?
It's still ticking up, but that just means...
Yeah, I got muted.
Yeah. All right. Well, now that you're unmuted, do you have any comments? We'll go to you next.
Really, nothing really other than to echo what Gene said, especially, I think, as previously noted during this budget process, just that the requests seemed almost to be too easy because it's the seemed like there weren't a lot of big asks this year, and I really appreciated the reflection of the administrative staff of that that was a result of, you know, the investments we've made in previous years, and that was a promise that we made to the town, and I think it's great to see that everyone feels comfortable that we're going to deliver the same excellent results in this coming year without having to add any major programmatic changes that are going to drive significant budgets. So I like what Gene said, that it felt like one of the easiest budget cycles we've ever been through. I think that's great.
Great. Nancy, did you have anything?
I don't have much to add to that, but I did want to highlight the fees. I thought it was appropriate to leave them where they are now, but that it would be worth looking at whether we want to keep them level in future years or continue what had been the trend of going down.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Not much else except to say I know that you highlighted at the beginning, you know, that the 6.99, I think it was higher before it got to you. So just a, you know, our hats off to everyone who went into that budget cycle really able to react probably to your shock or whatever you called it the first time you saw it, and then be able to professionally kind of bring it down to the first point that we saw it, and then given our feedback, everyone, you know, no one seemed frustrated or anything. And we gave feedback. They thought, you know, everyone seemed very open-minded when we gave, you know, our opinions on what they had presented. And, you know, the next week they would turn around and Ralph would have a new sheet for us for what changed from the last time that we met. So I mean, I would say we had a very easy job this year on our side of the table, but we wouldn't have had that if it had just been the same process year after year. I think you guys really took a lot of the brunt of the behind the scenes work that we'd never see. So thank you very much for making it easy for us this year. So that was great.
So the danger of going last is that everyone already said
all the good points were taken.
I mean, I would echo what Kelly said. What I was really impressed with this year is that, yes, I agree with everyone that it was easier because there weren't any outrageous requests, and not that there had been in past years that I've been here, but we didn't have any big programmatic changes that we really had to dive into. But even still, there were areas where we asked, why do we want to do that this year? Is it a need or a want? And you did go back and make those changes. I think the presentations this year were excellent in providing not only us the background for the thought process and why certain expenses were needed, but also just for our liaisons that were here and don't hear what's happening in the schools every day, like, or every other week like we do, and don't live it like you do. So I think the organization this year of the budget process and the thoroughness of the presentations were excellent. And I think also just the common sense nature of a lot of the decisions, you know, having Lauren DeBow say, we're not buying any supplies that we don't want to move because we're moving into a new building. I mean, that's what everyone wants to hear, is that you're looking at things with common sense and saying, well, we're moving into a new building, so we're not going to get a bunch of stuff that we have to then pack into moving trucks. We're going to use what we have and try and bring down that moving expense. So I think all of those examples were perfect examples of what was done so well this year. I know that you made our job easy, but that your job was very difficult for the first many months of this year. So thank you very much, because for us it was very smooth sailing. So I appreciate that. And yes, Ralph, we will definitely miss you. So I certainly will, because I don't have that finance background. So I'm with Gene on that one. I need hand-holding every so often to be told, what do the parentheses mean?
I'm sure you'll find somebody.
So, again, if anyone in the audience wants to speak or give a comment on the budget, you're more than welcome. If not, I'm not putting anyone on the spot for sure. Otherwise, I can take a motion to close our public hearing, and I can be a little more formal with that. So I would seek a motion to close the public hearing scheduled for this evening for the purposes of discussion of the fiscal year 2018 school department budget.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh, and this will be another roll call vote. Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
And I'm a yes, so it's unanimous and so carries. So we've now closed the public hearing portion of our meeting. And we have our new business item, which is the superintendent's budget recommendation.
It's 42,591. Go to the next slide.
He's coaching me even right up until the end.
Right there. 42,591,311.
42,591. So before I make the recommendation, I just want to take the opportunity publicly to also thank Mr. Dumas. I also needed a lot of help. And when you talked about his, you know, your little pink calculator, I've learned a tremendous amount from working with Ralph over the past four budgets. I didn't realize it was his 32nd, but it shows. For someone like me, for whom this is not an area of an expertise, we all really depend on Ralph to lead us through the process. And so although he kind of was surprised to hear the word flexible that applied to him, I think it's true. I think that we challenge him every day to help us to understand, and he has a job of making sure that we don't run out of money. And so, Ralph, I just want to thank you before I can't do it again publicly for all of that.
Thanks.
And so with that, the superintendent's recommendation for the FY18 budget is $42,591,311, which is a 4.13% increase over last year's budget.
Okay, I need that big number again, Ralph.
It is 42,591,311.
Okay. I'm going to give you all the opportunity to say any last words, any last questions. If none, then I will put the motion in front of us. I think that I'm going to put the number in there, even though it wasn't written in there. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the fiscal year 2018 budget recommendation of the superintendent in the amount of $42,591,311, which represents a 4.13% increase over the fiscal 2017 year budget.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. Again, this will need to be a roll call vote. Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
And I'm yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. And we have just finished our budget process. How lovely. Yeah. Our public has left the building. So our second opportunity for a comment that I actually publicly stated is unnecessary. And at this time, I would seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. And again, a roll call vote. Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
And I'm yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. And we are adjourned as of 7:43 p.m. And our next meeting is scheduled for Thursday, January 19th at 7 p.m. here in the high school library. And then we'll have another regular meeting February 2nd, 2017, 7 p.m. here in the high school library. Thank you and good night.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thanks, Ralph. I will not shake your hand because I'm sick.